Look at that out there. Another fabulous night in Brisbane. Here we are in a building in the South Bank Piazza where the walls don't go all the way around. Good News Week, live from Brisbane, wet and wild. Coming tonight from the South Bank Piazza as part of the 1999 Brisbane Writers' Festival. And the big news?
And you, for 2.5 weeks, tore me to shreds, but you left a toenail. The toenail is rebuilding. The toenail is coming back.
Jeffrey Gibb Kennett. Toenail one day, toe jam the next. Elton John is changing the words to Goodbye Melbourne's Toenail as we speak. Anyway, Victoria is now putting together a minority government, although it was previously run by a minority of one. Under these circumstances, most people would think their world had caved in, but not Jeff, not Jeff! Nah, Jeff thinks everyone else's world has caved in. So Kennett is cleaning out his pockets. In one of them, he found the Victorian Liberal Party. But at least it won't take long for Kennett to clear out his office. He's already done all that tedious document shredding. The bad news is, it's unlikely Jeff will stay on as opposition leader. He abolished that position years ago. Federal Education Minister David Kemp has come up with a plan to eliminate the nation's deficit and the nation's university students in one go. He's going to charge $100,000 for every degree. I mean, has he actually thought this through? At these prices, the only people with a degree will be Jamie Packer, Lockie Murdoch, and Australia's finest drug dealers. The Australian Defence Force targeted the Gold Coast Indy race this weekend, hoping to enlist young petrolheads who might be interested in serving in East Timor. The army can't solve all the problems in East Timor, but at least they can cheer up the locals by hotting up their cars. And young Australians would quickly earn the respect of the militia with their state-of-the-art handbrake turns and precision donut work. The recruitment office was actually in pit lane, so when Dario Franchitti pulled in to refuel, recruitment officers swarmed over to his vehicle, handing him brochures, fitting him with a uniform, and assigning him a machine gun. All in 6.3 seconds. The ADF needs the type of people that are found in pit lanes. Apart from engineering experts, the army has a critical shortage of women skilled in wearing lycra and leaning on vehicles. Cheryl Curnow's got a new job. She was Labor's Transport and Regional Services spokesperson, but she hated all the travelling. Is this the first time a politician has complained of too much travel? So now she's got employment. And imagine the tip she'll give to the unemployed. Join a political party. Get the top job. Double cross everyone. Join another party. Grizzle about the election result. Then whinge about your new job. Cheryl says the problem is she isn't one of Labor's major factions. That's for sure, she's in the women's faction. Thank you, sister. Hey. Cheryl joined the Labor Party expecting to have it all served up to her on a plate. Then she discovered ladies were just supposed to bring one. The Queensland Education Minister is investigating a scheme where school children buy their lunch from the tuck shop using plastic swipe cards called munchie cards. It won't change the lunch money economy. These days, most bullies accept munchie card. And if the tuck shop is closed, you can use the card to phone a special 00055 number where food is described to you in explicit detail. I reckon this is just the thin edge of the wedge controlling kids' eating habits. Eventually, the cards will only be redeemable for Brussels sprouts. The idea is, if parents don't give them cash, children won't be able to buy drugs. But remember, kids, as long as you've got your health, you can always trade sex for drugs. And that, ladies and gentlemen, is the good news. Tonight, from the gateway to the sun, the bright and shiny Julie McCrossan, the dark and mysterious Rod Quantock, and Olympic champion, broadcaster, and editor of the new national magazine, sportswoman, the lovely and talented Tracey Wickham! And they're sweating it out with the cool, calm, and collected Mikey Robbins, the hot and spicy Gene Kittson, 25 and already the best-selling author of High Station and Temple, the amazing, astounding Matthew Riley.
I'll tell you what, it's a beautiful Brisbane night.
Oh, and we've got lightning and rain. That's always great when there's a lot of electrical equipment around. All right, are you ready, Brisbane? Julie, Rod, Tracey, what's the story here?
Okay. Oh, a great big map.
A map?
With different colours on it.
Lots of numbers. Image and depth.
Conservation Council. Oh!
It's gonna be Queensland!
Apparently they're knocking down trees to build an ark.
Program, and in the last minute we've destroyed 50 years of Queensland tourism promotion. Sunny one day, drown to death the next.
I don't know if people at home can hear what we're hearing, but it is pouring with rain and there is flashing lightning behind.
I'll go out and stand in the water and I'll come back wet, okay?
We are getting wet here.
Anyway, look.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is very relevant to this story because what we've got here is a map revealing something connected. Woo-hoo.
David Copperfield, eat your heart out.
Come in too, Paul.
No.
I can't believe this ever seemed like a good idea.
Ladies and gentlemen, we're country people here on this panel. We're not put off by a little bit of weather.
has that hang on to something that floats.
We just think that clap of thunder is encouragement for our answer, Mr. Quantock.
Oh, right.
Well, it's been suggested you put down the lightning conductor.
Before.
Oh, thank God, you've had your fun. Paul, this is a story. This is a story about what's happening here in Queensland.
Yes.
There is talk that they're going to restrict the amount of acreage which can be cleared for farmland, and so in a rush to beat that legislation, farmers are going mad and clearing Queensland at the rate of 1 million hectares a year. In fact, if you come with me here for a moment, just come over here, you'll see. So they're rushing to clear before the legislation comes through.
He does have it right, 5 points. Queensland has one of the highest rates of land clearing in the world, with conservationists claiming the equivalent of 2 football fields of native vegetation are cleared every minute. But that's the great thing about deforestation in Australia. We'll always find a way of bringing it back to sport. And whenever we lose people in battle, we shouldn't talk about the number of lives lost. We should focus on the number of football teams we could have made out of the victims. Queensland farmers believe in a level playing field, and in 5 years, that's what the whole state is going to look like. But this is how Queensland farming works. You cut down all your trees so the federal government pays you to plant more. Then 5 years later, you cut those down and it happens all over again. Queensland cleared 340,000 acres of bush a year from 1995 to 1997. Where did all that scrub go? Where did it go? I bet I know. They waited till dark and then just chucked it over the fence. But the farmers do have a point. You can't have trees and animals in your way when you live in the bush.
Actually, a friend show. Before we go any further, I've got some good news.
Yep.
Well, not really, it's a note saying it's not actually lightning and thunder. The Indonesians have just taken Fortitude Valley, so...
Mikey, Jim, Matthew, what's good in here?
Right.
All right, okay.
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 It's a chef.
Angry chef.
Angry chef.
Angry, very angry chef.
Shitty chef.
McDonald's. The chef got sacked from
and,
McDonald's.
And police, yeah.
Police.
I know, there's more people are being ripped off by that McDonald's competition.
Yes, they're McMatch and Win, disgruntled McMatch and Win people.
That's right. Yeah.
Is it disgruntled chefs who were sacked from the McDonald's gourmet venture?
The French are complaining. How unusual. There's a tax in France that applies only to restaurants and not to fast food outlets like McDonald's. So they had a demonstration on the weekend, and when the cops tried to stop them, they floured them and egged them. Then roll them in breadcrumbs and saute the buggers.
I think what Mikey is saying that those French chefs were actually kicking the crepe out of those cops.
Angry French chefs attacked Paris riot police with eggs and flour to protest attacks on restaurant meals. Police responded to the flour bombs with water cannons, and several bystanders were badly battered. Another group protested by throwing egg whites. They were the separatists. Many have suffered for the art of French cooking. A huge protest parade of frog amputees is planned for central Paris. So after one tasty round of Good News Week, the McCrossan team are on 5 points. The Robbins team, 5 points. During the break, as we whetted our appetites, both teams were given 3 clues to a recent strange but true story. McCrossan, Quantock and Wickham have sheepskin. A artistic attire.
Artistic attire? I don't think you'd call it artistic attire. But nevertheless...
A man from Melbourne, a man from an artistic and creative background, a wonderful artist.
Come on, get those clothes off, let me paint you.
And finally this.
I have to sing.
Yeah.
Yay!
Blue moon, you left me standing alone.
Kittson and Riley received appeal.
Now, here's a guessing game. Where's the rest gone?
Don't ask me.
A G-string.
Here's another joke. Where's the rest gone?
And look, don't get sexist or I'll put it on and ruin everyone's night.
Finally,
you know
this.
That way?
Ba-dum, boom, boom. Get up, stand up. Stand up for your rights.
What is that?
Get up, stand up. Stand up for your rights.
Thanks.
Why am I here?
Well, you did that so well, you must be a slave to the gunja.
Oh, rest a man.
That's going to be so good later on. Right now, we start round two with bites. Julie, what's this foreign minister talking about?
Interfet must be able to exercise utmost restraint and not be trigger happy, especially close to the border.
Essentially, the foreign minister of Indonesia is making the suggestion that the UN troops in East Timor have to remain enormously calm, particularly when they're close to the border with West Timor, particularly when people have got various maps that don't necessarily say the same thing.
No, this is Ali Alatas. Do you know why he's upset? He's very upset because Australian troops shoot back, you see, whereas nuns and civilians don't, and it's just not fair.
Julie does have it right, 3 points. Indonesia is blaming Australia after both sides exchanged gunfire over a mix-up about the exact location of the West Timor border. The Indonesians were using a Dutch map from the 1930s, which has a skull and crossbones on it and an X that reads, "Here be treasure." And Interfet had an Indonesian map from the early 90s, which shows Australia as South Timor and East Timor as the killing fields. Still, it's no surprise Australia has the latest Indonesian army maps. We stole them from their packs when they were out here being trained. Anyway, the solution is obvious. Mark the east-west border more clearly. There needs to be a stripy gate, a double white line, and a little roadside stall that says, "Last chance, no more democracy for 200 Ks. Mikey, a bite for you from this little lady.
A bite? Oh, yes, I've always wanted a bite from a...
The elite. Oh. And the politicians want something. It's probably not in their interests.
She ought to know.
I'll tell you what, this is Bronwyn rabbiting on about the Republican referendum. She is, of course, in the monarchist camp. And she's anti the model that's being put forward because she says, you know, she'd rather have someone who's head of state decided by, well, who's someone shagged in the 16th century. And then manages to pass it down through 5 generations of inbred chinless morons. That's a great way to run a government.
I tell you something, I am loving this Republic debate. We've got people like Bronwyn Bishop and Peter Reith telling us a president elected by Parliament is wrong because you can't trust politicians. And then you've got people like Peter Costello and Simon Crean saying you can't trust the public to elect a president because look at some of the idiots they've voted for in the past. That makes sense. And Natasha Stott Despoja says, Australians want to wake up on November 7th with a post-referendum afterglow, having voted yes, 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 and enjoyed it. The monarchists immediately seized on her comments, saying it obviously meant a yes vote will leave the country completely rooted. They also unveiled James Blundell's mighty song, We'll Vote No in November. Sadly, many Australians who had planned to vote no immediately backed away slowly without making eye contact, frightened by this sudden outbreak of country music. Moving on now to Spot the Bull. Three alleged quotes from our fine national newspapers, but only one is true. Spot the Bull and find the truth. Tracey, an Australian survey has found 54% of computer users have experienced some form of computer rage. What form does this rage take? Screaming, crying, pleading, pretending it's not happening, running over it with a car?
That's what you did in bed last night.
Or is it swearing, threatening, hitting, attacking other objects in the vicinity, self-mutilation?
So you did in bed last night.
Or is it sulking, hiding, kicking, pouring water into the disk drive, murder?
Well, I think maybe the last one would probably be me anyway, because I'm a hopeless computer addict.
And you've also killed before, haven't you?
And I don't believe, number one, I could imagine someone swearing, threatening, hitting, attacking lots of other objects in the vicinity and self-mutilation. I'll leave number two.
I don't want to sit next to you anymore. You're strange.
Let's just see if Tracy's right. Bang!
Is that why they're called hackers?
Yes, 54% of users experience some form of computer rage, including swearing, threatening, hitting, dropping, and throwing. Some exceptionally frustrated people have even been known to double-click their mouse with an axe. But if they can make a computer that can design a skyscraper or run a space shuttle, why can't they make one that bounces? Everybody says they get computer rage when the computer won't let them do their work, but really, 9 out of 10 cases of computer rage are actually caused by losing at solitaire.
Ready to spot some... Do you know what I heard about computers?
Mm.
You know, if a woman designed a computer, we would design one that bounced. It would be all soft and have a mirror on it and somewhere to put your hot rollers. Yeah, do you know what I really hate? I hate that button that says enter. I think that's sexual harassment.
Mind you, though, you course that's always designed by a man because it crashes after 5 minutes.
Are you ready now to spot some bull, Matthew?
I'm way too sober for this, but okay.
Okay. A young New Zealand man by the name of Thomas Hendry is hoping to get on the TV show Guinness World Records Primetime with his unique act. How did he come to the show's attention? Did he... Oh, you're going to love this. Did he set fire to his own hair and got friends to toast marshmallows in the flames? Or he pulled out half his teeth with a pair of pliers and then made them into a necklace for his girlfriend?
Now, that says love to me.
Or he stapled his penis to a crucifix 18 times with an industrial strength stapler before dousing it with lighter fluid and setting it alight.
Is it a true? Before you answer, could I simply say none of these are recommended by this program?
If you are going to do it, boys and girls, put paper down first.
Any ideas, Matthew?
I've just entered the Twilight Zone. Setting fire to his hair. Paul, did you have that trouble at any stage?
My pubic hair caught fire once from friction. isn't a problem you've come across, Matthew.
No, Paul, a hand can do that.
New Zealander. Now, I don't think he set fire to his hair. May have pulled out half his teeth, but really, in the interests of great television, and whoever the person was who only stapled their penis to a crucifix 17 times. I really couldn't care less about the points. I'm going for number three for the principal.
Let's just see if the wily Matthew is right.
Method of contraception, wouldn't it?
Yes, he stapled his penis to a crucifix 18 times with an industrial strength stapler before dousing it with lighter fluid and setting it on fire for the great prize of $400 in cash and a $400 bar tab. Guinness World Records will classify Tom's trick under dangerous and disfiguring things you can do to yourself that smell like bacon.
How come you know burnt penis smells like bacon?
And once again, it's a friction thing. Sadly, Tom doesn't know if he'll be able to go ahead with the stunt under American conditions because their beer is much weaker. But Tom's penis isn't the only thing being stapled here. Think of the poor crucifix. The poor little figurine of Jesus had already been crucified on a cross. Then, when it was re-crucified on Tom's penis,
oh, please.
It didn't think things could get any worse. Then the fire came.
I think I've just figured out why the storm hit.
Yeah.
The good news is Tom is now working on his next trick, where he removes his own appendix using nothing but a hole punch and a ballpoint pen and a handful of post-it notes. He's also looking into the feasibility of performing a circumcision using an electric pencil sharpener. Horrified Crossan's 11 points, Quincy Robinson's 11 points. It's good news week. The game is 7 days and 7 seconds.
Oh, bugger.
Tracey, Rod, Julie, first story.
Is something to do with football? Is it the end of football?
Boxing. Oh, that was the next one.
No, come on, Mike.
First one.
Coming out of the room, looking
okay,
at the court.
OK, I'm going to throw it over there very shortly. On the count of four. One, two, three, four, five.
What?
No. I can't believe no one's going to get this.
Police station when that phone call was made. Hello, Dad? You sitting down? Oh, no, I can never tell either.
Okay, no points for that one, you cheats.
Oh!
Second story.
Sorry,
so women in boxing?
Second story.
The 6 billionth person in the world.
Thank you very much. 2 points. The third story.
Ali's daughter, the boxing.
Crashing at the moment, I'm going to go to you now.
We're talking about a great Australian film, a great Australian tradition, a great hat, a horse.
Yes, but
beautiful horse.
You don't know.
They weren't the life.
Who were they?
Okay. They were the ball horse.
Thank you very much. Another 2 points. Okay, the fifth story.
Kim Beasley.
Yes. What about him? What's he been in the paper for?
He's
what's he been in the paper for? Comments made by? Comments made by? In regards to?
East Timor.
And so his popularity is?
Down.
Thank you very much. 2 points. Next one.
Recently, the US Senate has rejected a nuclear testing ban.
Thank you very much.
Well, that's right. The only way they can find out if it's dangerous.
And finally, the last story.
Cold handguns are going out of the handgun business, only making semi-automatics.
Thank you very much. On 2 points.
You know, I've always thought I was stupid, but that's the first time I've really felt stupid.
In case you didn't miss them in that incredible rabble, the stories were John Howard's son Tim is fined for drink driving, but the magistrate doesn't recognise him because he says, sorry. The world's population reaches 6 billion, but the rate of increase is expected to decline as large parts of the planet become standing room only. The world's first male-female boxing match has ended with Margaret McGregor beating the crap out of Lloyd Chow. Margaret McGregor will now release a fitness video teaching women how to beat up men in the comfort of their own home. A group of old diggers on horseback commemorate the centenary of the Boer War. Since the rest of our army left for Timor, these are Australia's frontline defence. Kim Beazley blames his fall in popularity on Paul Keating's comments about East Timor. Up until then, Kim was doing very nicely, saying nothing at all. The US Senate votes to reject the comprehensive test ban treaty on nuclear weapons. A spokesperson said, they'll worry about it when the nuclear weapons start getting into the schools. Thanks, Mikey.
He liked it.
And to avoid lawsuits from victims of gun-related crimes, the Colt manufacturing company gets out of the handgun business, announcing that remaining stock will be sold as exotic body-piercing tools. Colt says their handguns are no match for that new, deadly, accurate weapon now carried by most Americans, a lawyer's phone number. The manufacturers claim they're not liable for gun-related injuries because they now put warnings on firearms like a smoking gun may damage your health, not to be used for senseless violence, and contains small, bullet-shaped parts which may be dangerous if swallowed at high velocity. The good news is Colt has seen the light and is moving into an entirely different industry. Tobacco. And after that phenomenal round of 7 days and 7 seconds, the McCrossan team are now on 15 points. The Robbins team, 21 points. Could we interest you in a little bad street fitter? Rod, come out and help yourself to a chocolate.
Yay!
Rod, I see you've got your French mime hat on. That's too easy. Got a hard one.
Yep, and Rod, your time starts now.
A cow that kills itself and cuts itself off.
It's something about its heart. Its little heart's beating. It's frightened. It's really frightened. And when cows get frightened, like stop.
They attack.
Dead frightened cows.
The sky.
It's a bird. It's a plane. It's super cow.
Right, move. Oh, the cow jumped out to the moon.
A satellite. A satellite.
Oh, the satellite fell down on the cow. And
the satellite is looking at the cow. Monitoring cows, and it's something like to improve their meat in some sort of way.
Yes.
Ah!
I don't know, McDonald's has got satellites monitoring satellite.
I'll give you a hint.
When their meat is at its best, when they're not stressed.
Oh, we're
meat are using them to monitor cows when they're happy, but also when they're stressed to decide when it's best to get meat.
It's good enough. Take it away. Very close. Swedish scientists are investigating ways of producing better quality meat.
I left out the Swedish part.
That's what I thought that was, Viking.
These Swedish scientists are investigating ways of producing better quality meat by preventing stressing cows on their way to the abattoir.
Well, some of them go into the pictures.
Well, essentially, yes. I mean, there might come a time in restaurants where you can order your steak relaxed, nervous, medium nervous, scared, and really quite terrified. The best way to get a low-stress beef burger will be to disguise abattoirs as health resorts. The cow arrives for its sauna and spa bath, is given a martini and a massage where all the tension is worked out of its frame by a Swedish masseuse with a sledgehammer hidden under the bed. Scientists are also looking at using satellite navigation technology to indicate the less windy and bumpy route to the abattoir. This will keep the cows in a state of blissful ignorance, apart from the ones who can read and are concerned about boarding a truck labelled Butcher Bob's Big Red Truck of Cow Death. Jean, your topic now.
Okay.
Well done.
Thank you. I don't mind if I lose. Oh, no. Oh, sorry.
Bit of snuff.
Bit of snuff.
Thank you.
Ah! Mm. Gee, it's long.
Thank you. Your time starts now, Gene.
Okay.
Video umpire. No.
Whole thing.
Fish.
Fish, fish.
Fish bowl.
Fish
tank.
Goldfish.
In the fish,
and
goldfish in the fish tank. Someone's walking.
Now, if you just bend on it, just bend on it.
Films. Squid! Squid! Oh, octopus! Yeah. Octopus!
The thinker. Fish.
So fish, two fish. Two fish. You sleeping. The fish. Do fish sleep? Oh, man. Man,
sleeping after a cigarette.
Man,
fish
man,
tank.
He's smoking the fish. Man, oh, one fish. Man got one fish. Man got one fish, but he's got breasts. It's really weird.
No. He's looking for the fish. Is the octopus looking for the fish?
Yeah.
Oh, hang on. Yes. Yes. Hang on.
Come on, dear.
Yes.
Come on.
Was climbing out of its tank.
That's it!
5 points! That was fantastic.
Gee, that was the most beautiful work I've ever seen.
That was actually life-changing for Matthew.
You doing anything later?
For those of you still slightly confused by that beautiful mime, a New York man who was bored with his goldfish installed a second tank for his new pet octopus, only to find his goldfish were mysteriously disappearing. So he set up a video camera and recorded the octopus climbing out of its tank, slithering along the floor, scaling the other tank, and eating a few fish, and then slithering back. And you thought a huntsman in your lounge room was scary. And there's also evidence the octopus knew it was being filmed. Just before it climbs back into its own tank, it turns to the camera and gives it the tentacle.
Excuse me, Mr. Friction.
Yeah. But
I feel used.
That's all right.
Is you'll it get, supposed to feel like that?
Well, not really, but you'll get used to it.
Just be thankful she didn't use a real octopus.
The unusually smart octopus also repositions the treasure chest and little plastic scuba diver to optimize the tank's feng shui. But if it can get out of the tank, it can go anywhere. I mean, you could wake up in the morning with a clammy set of dreadlocks. Or you could roll over in the middle of the night and think your brain had popped out and was sitting on the pillow beside you. And what if you woke up in the middle of the night to discover the wet spot on the sheets was ink?
You get your girlfriend to sleep in it.
No, if it could crawl, if this octopus could crawl, what if it ended up in your toilet, which is an obvious place, and then you went there in the morning and you looked at it? Yeah, and you said to yourself, I don't remember eating that.
Them now on 20 points, them on 26 points. It's good news week. Tracey, your strange but true clues were the sheepskin, that artistic attire, and that beautiful song.
Blue moon, blue moon, you left me standing alone.
You may remember that this is to do with sheep. You see, it's to do with sheep. And the Americans don't want our lamb imports. They don't want them. And John Howard went to America representing our sheep. And I don't know if you... I don't know. And the Americans don't want our sheep, which means technically our sheep are unemployed. So what we're doing now with our sheep to keep them interested, because there's nothing to do in a paddock and they're drifting into big cities and people are finding them on street corners shooting up and... stealing your VCR and eating your lawn. So what we're trying to do now is to get them to do art. And what they're doing now is they're dipping sheep in paint, and farmers are throwing them at canvases, and you're getting this wonderful sort of pointless sheepy effect, which is doing wonderfully well.
Is from Melbourne and surprisingly close and yet not quite there. What we're looking at here is the extraordinary imagination of the modern artist. You simply get your sheep, you paint them blue, and you take them to a country town in Victoria.
And see blue me!
There's an artist who's been painting sheep blue, penning them in different shapes.
Not only blue, but in a range of colours, blue, and he puts them in order in a pen, and when you look from a satellite, be looking at cows
it's to stress their breath level. It's to do with Geelong.
It's to do with Geelong. Tracey, how's it?
Yep. Victoria, they had the sheep in, like little cage pen things, in the shape of Victoria, and the blue section, the blue sheep, was the outline of Geelong.
Geelong is riding on the sheep's back. It's just a work of art.
Yes.
Thank you very much, they do have it. Victorian artist Glenn Romanus corralled 500 sheep, half-dyed blue, into an intricate design symbolising Geelong and the surrounding countryside, part of a work titled Such Fertile Ground, Big Art for a Big Country. Glenn Romanus says his influences are Picasso, Toulouse-Lautrec, and the Department of Primary Industry. The good news is John Howard says his government would happily support more art like this because he's always felt the only good art is art you can eat when you get bored with it. Mikey G. Matthew. you. You were given the peel.
The peel.
Which has gone soggy and nasty and brown over the course of the show.
The G-string.
Which hasn't gone soggy and nasty and brown, I'm very glad to say.
And that's
boom, 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 get up, stand up.
Oh, yeah.
Stand up for your rights.
Lively up yourself, Matthew Mann.
Now, this very fancy thing, is G-string, is about dancing. It's about dancers and it's about lap dancers, isn't it?
There was a woman in California. She was doing her routine, which I believe is a hell of a show. She was busted. She said that it was part of the First Amendment, freedom of expression.
And it is in the Constitution, freedom of expression.
It's amazing. You can't burn the flag, but you can get your gear off.
You can jump on men's laps. You can do all that, because it is self-expression. It's saying, I'm naked and you've got money. Really?
They have it. Our Californian appeals court has thrown out the conviction of seven exotic dancers, finding lap dancing is protected by the US Constitution. As far as the Constitution is concerned, the court ruled lap dancing is no different to a D.H. Lawrence novel or one of Shakespeare's plays. Great news for strippers, even better news for English students.
They found out, yes, it was in the Constitution, but Bill Clinton had written it in green texter.
The judgment now means it's now legal to carry a lap dancer as long as she's not concealed, and you're also allowed to have one in your car. But there is a 7-day cooling off period between ordering your lap dance and actually getting it. Just a hand, the Pope is demanding to know who answered the Vatican doorbell last Friday after the Shroud of Turin was ruined by the Nappy Sand Challenge. Oh yes, this face is completely gone. In this boudoir, Julie Macross and Rod Quantock and Tracey Wickham scored a steamy 27 points. Bumped by Mikey Robbins, Gene Kittson, and Matthew Riley on a sticky 30 points. They have it. So we say Good News Week. We'll return to the South Bank Piazza in Brisbane next week for our difficult second show. Do join us, won't you? For now, we leave you with the good news that the Conservation Council says land clearing is the single greatest threat to Queensland's unique biodiversity. Who are they fooling? The single greatest threat to the Queensland environment has been, and always will be, Schoolies Week.
Wednesday, it's 10 special 2-for-1 deal. Watch one brand new episode of TV's funniest comedy and get one free. Just shoot me at the special time of 8:30 Wednesday on 10. Next or the latest with 10 News.